So, welcome to my talk, Bayadera, BIAS plus Clojure plus GPU. My name is Dragan Djuric, and I'm a professor of software engineering at the University of Belgrade. You can find me online. The libraries that I will talk about could be reached at this address, uncomplicate.org. Lots of documentations there, of course, open source. Oh,
sorry.
Yeah. Well, maybe tune it a little bit. Okay, so now it's better. This presentation can be found also on dragon.rocks. There is a blog post. Well, it's .rocks because .com was taken, so. So there is the presentation there. You can reach speaker notes, so you don't have to take notes. Just relax and follow the talk. Also, you can contact me on these social media. Whatever you have to ask about these stuff. So, let's start. A little background. What are we going to talk about today? A bit of Clojure, a bit of GPU computing, and of course, Bayesian data analysis. So, what is Clojure? It's a modern pragmatic Lisp that runs on JVM, which is Java Virtual Machine, which is, for many people don't like it, but I think it's like the best and one of the most performant virtual machines and programming environments, so give it a chance. So, Clojure is great. How many of you are using Clojure? Wow, I'm pleasantly surprised. And how many of you have heard about Clojure? And not you. Well, cool. So there are people who are interested in this talk. Good stuff. Okay, so Clojure is great. I won't talk about it more. Now, Clojure and Java are fast, but are they good at number crunching? Well, they are good, certainly. Roughly as fast as C. But they are not great for numerical computing and number crunching. Why? Because JVM doesn't have access to hardware-specific optimization for various hardware. So even for Intel processors, native stuff that is optimized for the processor can be much, much faster, like 5 or 10 times or even more. We can make it great, and I'm creating some libraries, and I invite you to help to create some more. But CPU is not so great for number crunching either. So, for example, R or Python, they have lots of libraries that run really well, and they can help you solve your problems, but the point is, if you have a problem that is not that has not already been implemented, then it's a disaster. Like, you have to write lots of optimized C code, lots of glue. Not really nice, and certainly not nice for functional programmers. I'm certain of that. And also, CPU is not that great at number crunching compared, for example, to GPUs, because it has many features which requires transistors and hardware, which creates heat and also costs money. So that brings us to GPUs, or graphical processing units, which have many very simple cores, and those cores are not really capable of much stuff, but what they are capable of, this is exactly what we lack in JVM. So it's a good fit. What Clojure is good at, creating Clojure. But then what is good for really high performance computing, these parts should be created to run on GPUs. The problem is that GPUs are really, really, really hard to program. So the programming tools are from the Stone Age, I think. And one of my goals is to make this better, to get a bit of closureness to it. So Uncomplicate is a family of open source closure libraries for scientific and high performance computing. And my main goal, how I started doing this, is was to create some Bayesian machine learning software. Unfortunately, this kind of software like really requires lots and lots of computations, and JVM and libraries that were available at the time weren't really performant enough for that. So I started creating some infrastructure and then some more infrastructure, and then very quickly I found myself like doing the numerical stuff instead of my Bayesian stuff. But fortunately, I'm getting back to Bayesian and machine learning, because I created lots of this for closure. So some of these libraries are FluoKitten, which is a library for doing monadic stuff in closure, something that Haskell programmers are really fond of. Then ClojureCL, which is a closure library for taking full control of your accelerators and graphical processing units, another OpenCL-enabled hardware. So, but with a twist, without much overhead. So basically, it should be as performant as if you wrote this in C or OpenCL-C. Then Neanderthal goes a bit further. It's a library for providing the matrix computations with almost no overhead. And it's very, very idiomatic for closure, and still almost as fast as anything you will find on CPUs. And it also supports graphical processing units. And finally, Bayadera, a library that I will talk about today, which is a Bayesian data analysis library for closure that runs on GPUs. Of course, what does all this have to do with bias? Why even going to GPUs? Why don't just using some like Stan or JAX, which are state of the art C++ libraries? Well, the point is, Bayesian data analysis is really conceptually really, really simple conceptually, but then the point is you have to do numerical simulations to solve the real models from the real world, and these numerical computations really explode with dimension. So as soon as you get out of the hello world area, basically your models run in many minutes, hours, even weeks, even more. So each speed up is welcome. So it's important here. So closure is good for high level stuff, good for modeling complex dynamical models. GPUs are good for really fast computations, and I think it's a good match. The problem is Markov chain Monte Carlo algorithm, which is usually the algorithm that you simulate all these Bayesian models with, is a sequential algorithm. So it's a not really good candidate for parallelizing on GPUs. Fortunately, there are variants that could be parallelized, and I did it on GPUs. So when should we use Bayesian data analysis at all? The answer is wherever we don't have much data. When we have small data, Bayesian analysis is the right choice. And how is it done? Well, often we cannot directly measure what we are interested in. We can only measure some effects that are caused by this thing that we are interested in. So then the point is how to get back, how to get from the, if the arrow is pointing there, how and we can measure this, how to go back. Well, by bias rule, and now I see, now I have seen that it seems that there is no internet connection here, so my math formulas are messed up. So, what to do with that? Now nothing. But if you access this online, it will be fine. So, basically this is bias rule in mathematical expression. So, we have probabilities of all answers. And this is our prior. So we believe something, or we have previous knowledge that tells us we should believe something. Then we have data, which gives us evidence. And then we can calculate backwards from the priors and the evidence and likelihoods, probability of data given hypothesis, to the other stuff. Reverse stuff, probability of hypothesis given data. So we have data, it's given, we measured it, then we calculate what we should believe out of this. And of course, if you're not into Bayesian stuff, it's quite confusing, or you don't really, you're not sure what I'm talking about. If you want to know more, this is the best, I think, book for learning it. It's an excellent tutorial, but it actually gives the real examples, not the easy stuff that you cannot really use, but the examples from real analysis that are really used in scientific work. So let's start with the hello world. We want to know whether a coin toss or a coin is fair coin or a trick coin that falls on one side more than the other. So we cannot we describe this tendency with theta. So it's a tendency of the coin to fall on one side or the other. It's a number between 0 and 1 in this case. We cannot measure it directly, so we cannot attach a measuring device to the coin. We can only make an experiment, and we know that this experiment is influenced by the theta. We measure how many times coin falls on the head or on the tails, and then we calculate backwards to see what should we believe. Is theta like 0.3 or 0.4 or 0.75838. Fortunately for these kinds of simple problems, as the coin is, there is analytical solution. So we can mathematically calculate the answer, just plug in the numbers into the formula, and we get the answer. Why we do this today? So it's easier for you to create a mental model of what we are doing here. So the analytical solution, we have likelihood, which is probability of data coming this way or another, given that we believe some theta. So if theta is some specific number, then z number of heads out of n throws has some probability. And we can calculate in this case, because we have a formula, we can calculate the exact specific probability for each possible theta, and there are infinite number of thetas. Also, we then choose the prior. So the formula that describes what we believe to be the conjugate of this likelihood. Why the conjugate? Because that's the function that fit nice into the likelihood, so we can calculate it to get the nice answer as the posterior. So prior is what we believe before we get the data, so some prior knowledge. Likelihood is comes out of the data that we actually had. For example, one head out of 10 throws, and the posterior tells us, okay, now this function is a bit different. So the example from the book that I've mentioned before is we describe the first diagram shows us shows what we believe before. We say, okay, we believe the Hoehn is fair, but we are not very sure. So that's why this shape. Then we measure the data and we say, okay, we threw the coin 10 times and we got one head. Should we believe that theta is 0.1? Of course not. 0.1 is really probable. But other values of theta are also probable, just a bit less. And then the lowest diagram is the diagram that shows the posterior, what we believe based on the prior knowledge and also the data that we got. Should we believe the one or the other? No. We should make the compromise, and the answer is actually somewhere between. The most probable answer is that theta is around 0.3 in this case, but 0.5 is also a bit probable, and 0.1 is also probable, just less than 0.3. That's what Bayesian analysis gives us. Probabilities that we can understand, and that really shows what is due to our beliefs and what is due to real data. So in this case, Bayadera gives us some probabilities probability functions that could be used to compute this. It's really easy because we just say, okay, the prior was beta prior, posterior will be beta. We just plug in the actual parameters from the example that Kruschka gave. We call beta CDF function with these actual numbers, and we get the cumulative probabilities, and we get the answer to the question, what is, for example, the probability that theta is between 0.5 and 0.6? And we calculate it here that it's 0.15. Unfortunately, for the real models, we never have such nice models. So analytical solution is probably not possible in the actual analysis that you need to do. So what is one of the solutions? For example, libraries such as Bayadera, which is in this case a closure library that is highly opinionated, is Bayesian, and the point is that it needs to be really fast, thus GPUs, so it is really, really fast. And I hope that it will be a foundation for Bayesian machine learning algorithms in the future. Some of its main goals are contrasting to the other libraries in this space that are more mature. This library is not built for data scientists, although they can use it. It's primarily built for me and people such like me, and these are programmers. People who would like to use machine learning or Bayesian analysis, but would really like to use a nice programming language, performant environments, and to be able to integrate this into real production software that runs the servers with really great performance. And they also would like to extend it, probably. So they would like to use the technologies that they like, which means closure, or if you don't, oh. So another mathematical glitch, unfortunately. I'm sorry, I apologize. So when you open this online, it will be all right. Now it's difficult to to see what it looks like, but the point is, when you do need this simulation with multidimensional models, the point is that you cannot do it analytically, you have to do it numerically. And you cannot do it by brute force, because you will need to do so many computations that it would be probably several centuries until you do it for real models. And the most of the points that you would compute would be zero anyway. So you would waste time. The answer for such problems is Markov chain Monte Carlo. And so should we switch this? Oh, thank you. So this is command. What happens now? Oh. No, I pressed S. Maybe I should open it from the blog. Just 30 seconds and we will know. So it works now. Okay, now I don't have speaker notes, but I don't need them. Now it's much nicer formula. So the point is, as you can see, if we try to do this by brute force, the problem is that we have to do we would have to do lots of products of vectorized stuff. This could be really wide vectors. Then we would have to divide it by multiple integrals. So basically, we would to get the answer, we would have to do the computation that is hard, then to multiply it by a computation that is acceptable, and then to divide by something that is impossible to compute. So, not really a good thing. So Markov chain Monte Carlo is a family of simulation algorithms that enables us to draw samples from an unknown distribution. Basically, we have to get this the samples from the MCMC. With the MCMC, we just have to compute the upper stuff, the hard times acceptable, then do it really many times, maybe millions, maybe billions, maybe zillions, who knows? But then it's not impossible, it's just hard. I mean just hard, but it's better than impossible. So let's do the same coin sample. MCMC is not necessary in this case, but why not try it? Good as a hello world. So this is how to do it on the GPU with Bayadera. Don't be afraid. This is a low-level example on purpose. So I'm doing every unnecessary step here. So I could do this in half the steps here, and also once you create a model this way, you can use the usual closure abstractions, like create a function out of it, so your users don't have to write this all the time, just parameterize it. So basically, what we do is we create some GPU context with default Bayadera. Then we create prior distribution as a general distribution with some parameters. Like beta, we use beta function, like beta distribution. Then we get the sampler for this distribution, and this sampler is able to sample, so to give us many samples that we need. In this case, I didn't need to start the MCMC process because this problem is not really difficult, so the process was like immediate. Basically, then we just create posterior, which is binomial likelihood times beta distribution. So these few calls will actually extract the GPU C code that is needed, and then assemble the model under the hood, and that model would go to GPU. So basically, you wrote a lot of GPU code with this without even touching C. And what is the result of this? Notice how smooth this curve is. And this is not the interpolation. This was generated by this presentation, so the code running in this presentation in Emacs org mode. The point is that there are tens of thousands or million samples here. So I just simply plotted each dot from the sample. and I got the perfectly smooth result. So sometimes it's an overkill, but sometimes you just can't do it because it was immediate in a millisecond or two or 10, I don't know. So I did it. But let's get to some real world examples. Something you couldn't compute with analytical solution, but it's not too complex, so we have to wait 10 days for it. This is a problem from the Krushke's book. Not too difficult, not too easy. The point is that it runs in several hundred seconds with JAGS and STAN, which are state-of-the-art software. The problem is we have 300 measures of height and weight of people. So we would want to do some linear regression and see whether there is a connection and what is the actual connection between them. In contrast to the classical linear regression, I'm not interested in one line that has the most probability. I'm interested in all lines that have some probability. So I don't want to throw any information. I want to get the nice distribution of all lines that are more or less good fit for this data. We create a hierarchical model. So we say X is height, Y is weight. And then we say Y is beta 0 plus beta 1 times X1, so it's a regression. But I'm not sure about the parameters beta 0 and beta 1. And also Y is distributed around this line with student's t distribution. And this distribution has some parameters, and I'm not really sure what are these parameters. So basically, in this case, I have a four-dimensional random variable, beta 0, beta 1, nu, and what is this, sigma. And I also have some parameters, like 7 or 8 parameters, like m0, s0, M1, S1. You can create these hierarchical models however complex you want. So it's your choice where to stop. And from the Krushke's book, results with JAGS and STAN, as you can see, we get some nice distributions of those parameters, the most believable values, and some that are less believable. And then these black lines shows where is the 95% of the mass. It is not a confidence interval. It's high density interval, which is a different thing. And also 95% is arbitrary. We could have used 89%. It's the same. Just the most of probability mass. And one of the points is that I invite you to note is that these histograms are really rough. You can see that they just plot like bar charts. It would be nicer if these were smooth lines. Bayadera can give us that. So, how to do it in closure with Bayadera? The first slide, we read the data from CSV files. Nothing special here. This is low-level closure code. I didn't use any library that would help me. I just used normal, just the easiest closure code, not that simple. It could be simpler, but it's normal closure. Now, something interesting. Similarly to the previous example, we use some stuff that is already built into Bayadera. All these standard distributions that we use in these hierarchical model that you have seen. So we use Gaussian distribution, uniform distribution, T distribution, exponential distribution. But then we have to create this model ourselves because all this stock stuff, now our model is specific. We have to provide a bit code for that. We provide it in robust linear regression header. So it's a C code for GPU, but it's straightforward, it's easy. I will show it to you. So this is actually the code from Bayadera that reads this C code, mixes it up with the other code that I already wrote, general code for other distributions and for the engine and whatever else, and then enables you to run it on the GPU. And here is the likelihood function that we have to write. You can see it's simple stuff. This is like the most basic C that you can see elsewhere. So I read the data, those 300 points, for each point that I have to compute. I read those 300 points. This is params. I read x. X is actually the random variable that I'm trying to guess. And I just compute the t distribution. So I compute the likelihood function for each x and for each set of data points, all 300 data points. So basically, this function will be will do 300 loops for each data point. This is the description of prior, even easier. I use some standard functions that are already built in Bayadera to get my specific models prior. And now we run it. So this is not a code snippet. This is the actual code that I used to generate diagrams from this presentation. So I didn't just copy-paste the code. This code is enough to get the whole analysis. That's the point. I guess it's even simpler than the actual state-of-the-art tools, although it uses GPU. As you can see, it's some easy closure, I'd say, once you get the meaning of those functions. Nothing too difficult to understand, just random closure, as I hope your closurists here would agree. So the important stuff that we didn't use before is this mix function. This is a function that I created that tries to run several batches of MCMC and then see whether it converged or it should be run more. So basically, you can do it step by step. You can use some built-in functions. It's up to you, programmers. And also, there is a nice, easy histogram function that will take your sample and create histogram on the GPU really, really fast. And here is how I created the diagrams that you will see. The point is, you don't have to use this plotting library. I just created it as a toolbox of Bayadera because it's high performance, can plot really many points on the plot really fast, but you can use any closure plotting library or any Java plotting library to generate diagrams. It's up to you. Here are the histograms that I got. You can see that these are really smooth compared to the actual histograms that we have seen from the book, which are like bar charts. These are also bar charts, but there are so many of them that you appear smooth. And also, it automatically calculates the 95% high density interval, which is a green line here. And also, this library supports theming, so you can get different colors. But it's really like just a help from the toolbox for programmers. I didn't intend it as a real plotting library. So it's up to you whether you will use this plotting or some other general plotting library. It's not the main point here. Well, now, how fast it is. We are comparing apples to oranges in some sense, but for these particular examples, I took 61 million samples, which are not really some easy samples. Remember, 300 points, each sample needs a loop and everything else. So 61 million samples in 260 7 milliseconds, which is like 4 nanoseconds per sample. And we give really very precise histogram. Jax and Stan, the example from the book, he took 20,000 samples, only 20,000, but these tools needed 200 seconds for that. So it's 9 milliseconds per sample. So basically, if we compare apples to oranges, then it's 2 million times faster. But it's not really fair because, well, we didn't do the same stuff. But if we compare the whole analysis, like we don't care about number of samples, just tell me the time that I needed to wait to get the answer, then Bayadera was 1,000 times faster, which I hope you agree is a lot faster. So in real life, why would we need this? I mean, it's a split second, but few milliseconds here and there, but it's 1 second versus a couple of hours or one day versus months or year. So I think it's worth it. So thank you. That would be all today. The presentation is a DragonRox. All the code is open source. You can find these libraries at these addresses. Bayadera is not there yet, but it will be. Other libraries that I used here are all already available, so you can use them. So thank you. We can receive some questions now. And if I don't have time to answer some of your questions, feel free to ask me wherever you find me here or online. I will be happy to answer that. Thank you. So the question is about the benchmarks. So the question is, how much of this speed up is attributed just to running it on GPUs instead of, so what would it happen if we could port Stan to GPU, right? Yeah. So the point is, you cannot port Stan to the GPU because the algorithm that they are using is not parallelizable. So there are many different kinds of MCMC. It's just an umbrella, let's say, of algorithms. So I used the affine variant. I forgot the name. There is a paper maybe 5 years ago or so that people actually created a special MCMC algorithm that can be run in parallel. So that algorithm have been implemented on the CPU. And it's available, I think, for PyMC3, but I'm not sure. There is an implementation on GitHub of this similar algorithm as this one, just on CPU. And when they compared it to Stan, it was similar speed. So the point is, this algorithm implemented on the CPU would be comparable to Stan. Maybe it would be 5 times faster or 2 times slower, I don't know. Because it's difficult to compare, depends on the model, depends on the actual data, circumstances and all. But the point is, if you could speed up Stan to the GPU, it would probably be the same speed as this or a bit slower, like let's say 10 times slower. But the point is, you cannot port a Stan's algorithm to GPU because it's not parallelizable. So it's a bit of both.
Is it absolutely necessary to write C code, or could you generate this with the code for those C codes?
Yeah. So the question is it absolutely necessary to write C code? This bit chunk of C code. could we generate it from closure? Well, yes, we can generate this from closure, but I'd say it's better to write it in C. Because when you write software for GPU computing, it's important to be aware what you can do and what you cannot do. So if we could create a library in closure to generate this code, it wouldn't be simpler than this. Because I already generate lots of code. For example, you have seen maybe 20 lines of C that could be really compressed to maybe 6 lines of C. I on purpose gave like written code. But the point is, there is also probably a few thousands of lines of code that is running these models. I just generate models on the fly, basically. I just need those 20 lines because these are specific for this actual model. But the point is, once you create the model, there is no need for your users to write any C code. You just abstract it into the closure function, and they just use it as a normal closure code. That's the point. Excuse me. Okay, thank you. So the question is, what Bayadera provides out of the box besides linear regression? And the answer is, it doesn't even provide linear regression. So this is a low-level library for writing Bayesian data analysis. So basically, whatever you can do with, and other tools are also the same. So Stan or JAGS, they don't provide as themselves. They don't provide like the pre-packaged linear regression. It's up to you to build it and maybe provide it as a library. So the point is, Bayadera enables you to create arbitrary distributions, to create arbitrary hierarchical models, and then it's up to you what kinds of models you will create with it. So maybe a good answer would be Bayadera is one layer. And then you can use it to create a machine learning libraries that provide, I don't know, linear regression or some classification on whatever you need. We have to. Okay, the question is, okay, it is a lot faster, but how good it is in terms of convergence, of the quality of answers. So the point is, the algorithm that I used for creating this MCMC algorithm specific, in the literature where they tried it and compared it to other algorithms, this algorithm was really good because it came from the astronomy field. It's like parallel to statistics. Statisticians have one way of solving problems, and the astronomers have lots of similar problems, but they have like a separate track how they solve it. So they just created a good algorithm that is really nice and simple and parallelizable. And maybe per sample, it converges slower, but it enables you to take million times more samples. So you just brute force it. And the other point is how good it is. You've seen this example. So I got the answer, but with just much more detail and with in much less time. So the point is, you're not sure because there are different kinds of models. But generally, I didn't optimize to this model. So in all models that I've tried, I've got better results. This model was just a good example from the book because it's a good description, it's not simple, it's not complex either. So it's just a good example for showing. But it's not, I didn't optimize benchmark or Bayadera for this model, if you asked. It should be really a good solution for arbitrary models. So we had one question. Can we get this? Well, the question is, how do you debug it and profile it? Because it's usually difficult on the GPUs. Well, the answer is actually the debuggers and profilers that you get with OpenCL, for example, from AMD for their GPUs, wouldn't work with this because they need your host C code and device C code. So you couldn't use these tools for debugging this code, but don't despair, because 95% of the code that you would write would be Clojure code. So you can debug it and profile it with Clojure and Java profilers. And the point is that you have the benefit of dynamic and programming and the REPL. So you can experiment with the REPL, although it's GPU code, it doesn't matter. So it's really, you can start from the simpler thing and then just experiment with this. And I didn't, although I had to create this tool from like the basics, I didn't, debugging and profiling were not my problems here.
Okay, thank you very much for your talk.
Thank you.